Well, good morning. Welcome to Liberty Baptist. I hope you're awake. Everybody awake? Yeah. All right. Well, somebody is because you said something back to me. Maybe you ought to try that out during the sermon. Well, if you're here, we're very happy you're here. If you're a visitor with us, you are our special guest. So please don't get out of here today without filling out a visitor card, dropping it in the offering plate before you go. Now, I have two very brief announcements. One announcement is I'm taking a great risk, a big risk. I have planned the schedule in such a way, we have planned the schedule in such a way that over the next 5 weeks, we need 300 volunteers. You say, oh my goodness, how did that happen? Here's the way it goes. Celebration choir for Harvest Day, we need 40. Come tonight, 7 o'clock, and practice. If you want to be part of the celebration choir, which is you don't have to be able to sing, you just need to be enthusiastic, okay? You can work on that one. Number two, all of this is in your bulletin, by the way. We need volunteers for helping with Railroad Day. We need 12 to 15 volunteers. You can sign up in the main office or online. We also need people to ride in the float at Railroad Day. We need 60 to do that. We have two floats, okay? Between Autumn Fest and Scarecrow Hollow, we need 100 volunteers to pull it off. And then by Trunk or Treat, we need 60 volunteers. Total them up, right at 300. Now, I have not done this in about 5 years, but I believe this is a time in our church life where we need to hit the gas. And I'm hitting the gas. But don't let me outrun you. You understand? You must get on board. I'm serious. You think I'm joking? I'm not joking. Because we need 300 volunteers to service about 7,000 people, which means we need you on board. Now, that brings me to the other issue, and that is $181,000 by our 181st year anniversary. That's coming right around the corner. We were involved in $216,000 by the year 2016. Well, we've reduced that. We want to do as much as we can by Harvest Day. And let me just tell you what I'm asking. I know many of you are giving systematically to the Ministry Center, and praise God for that. Praise God for that. So don't you need to feel any pressure to give any more? I know many of you are giving sacrificially. But this is what I am asking. If you're not giving, or you feel as though you could give more, why not on Harvest Day give a one-time gift? Why not say, I'm all in here to this new thing Liberty Baptist is doing, and say, I'll give a one-time gift to do as much as we can towards this $181,000 by 181 years. Now, one of the reasons we're doing this is to help our children's ministry. This building will help a lot of things, but one thing it will really help is our children's ministry, and here's a video that highlights some of the things that will be helped.
I'm in TNT.
Sparks.
Sparkies.
I'm in Trek.
I love Wanaka because we can grow closer and we have more spiritual time with each other. We can grow together and tell other people about Jesus.
Acts 16:31. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved.
We go into a time where we discuss and then we say memory verses to each other.
Mrs. Puckett tells us stories.
And we get to learn about the Bible and Jesus.
I like game time because dodgeball is my favorite.
We have fun cheering on each other, have a lot of competition.
First we play a different game, then sometimes he says we can play dodgeball for one or two or three times or just zero.
We play like kickball, dodgeball.
It's pretty loud.
You better have some headphones or some earplugs. Or you better already take in your aspirin because you're going to get a headache.
I'm looking forward to being in the new building because you can have lots of room to run.
Because we're just going to have a lot of more space in it, and it will not be so tight together.
It'll give them the real effect of a real size Awana circle.
I'm excited about it because it'll help us have more outreach so we can get in more with the community, and a lot more people will be able to come to this Awana program.
Church is important, and the new building is part of the church, and so it's kind of like important to the church and all of the people in the church.
I encourage you to give to the new building because it's going to reach boys and girls in Appomattox, but not only reach boys and girls in Appomattox, it's going to reach their families as well, their moms and dads and grandparents, to be involved in their life. And I can't think of a better place to be than Liberty Baptist.
Whatever God provides for this church, He'll keep it going.
Open the gates of righteousness for me. I will enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous will enter through it. I will give thanks to you because you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This came from the Lord. It is wonderful in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice and sing. Rejoice. Again, I say rejoice. Let's stand together as we rejoice in the Lord.
Thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up
we come to you today. And God, we certainly have a busy church schedule in front of us, but God, may we ever be in communion with you. God, in the midst of that which we are doing, may we be much more concerned with what you are doing. And God, may we have spiritual eyes open and hearts attuned, not only to our own selves and to our own areas of growth, but God, may you make us mindful of people around us who are struggling, people who are separated from you. And God, may you help us through words spoken and actions demonstrated to be your hands and feet. God, we realize our imperfections. We realize our weakness. But God, we pray that by your power, that you would overcome all of that and show yourself mighty through it all. So God, we hold this service up before you. Holy Spirit, may you have your will and way. God, may not only your message be delivered, but God, may your people respond. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he has provided grace for us, grace without measure, because of his love for us. Let's stand together as we sing about the wonderful grace of our Lord.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free, by God my Savior has ransomed me.
Let us pray. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the unending love of amazing grace. Father, we come this morning, many with burdened hearts, but Father God, we can lay those burdens at the foot of the cross because you have paid the price. You have gone to Calvary's cross and shed your precious blood that each one of us might have that unending love and amazing grace. And Father, I thank you for each one that is present this morning. I thank you for their commitment and their love to you. Father, I ask that you open our hearts even more, that we might feel your touch, feel your presence, and that we might be filled with the Holy Spirit to go out and to help those in need around our community, around this nation, and around this world. Father, we thank you for all the activities yesterday, Father, for the clothes closet and for compassion ministry or ministries of compassion, and for the new members class and for the Bible studies. And Father, I just ask that you continue to guide and direct us here at Liberty. Father, as we now come to this portion of the service, that we give back a portion of what you have so richly and graciously blessed us with, I ask that you might bless both the gift and the giver and use them for the advancement of your kingdom here and in Appomattox and around the world. And we ask it all in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Sun and disaster comes, oh my soul, oh my soul. When waters rise and hope takes flight, oh my soul, oh my soul. brought rain, and disaster came. Oh my soul, oh my soul. When waters rose and hope had flown, oh my soul, oh my soul, oh my soul. Ever faithful, ever true, you I know can never let.
You know, in life, what often separates, just in a worldly way of thinking, what often separates successful people from struggling people is that successful people often are able to see opportunities in front of them and then take advantage of the opportunities they are given. If you often listen to unsuccessful people, they often make excuses why there never are opportunities. They never seem to see the opportunities. And even when they see them, sometimes it takes them forever to actually seize upon those opportunities. And that's just in a merely worldly way of thinking. Look at people you see as so, quote unquote, successful. Why are they successful? Because they see opportunities other people don't, and they seize upon those opportunities like other people have not. Now, the most interesting thing is about this is that this same principle can be applied in a very spiritual way. You know, oftentimes successful people are looking for opportunities to build whose kingdom? Their own. But you see, God is in the kingdom-building business. He tells us to pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And the same principle now applies in another context. I would say that faithful Christians are those who see God-given opportunities and seize upon them for God's kingdom and God's glory. And today, this message is delivered in a strong way by Jesus to His church, an ancient church, at the church at Philadelphia, but this message resonates to us today. I remember early in my ministry career here at Liberty, I arrived at Liberty's campus at the ripe old age of 22. Can you believe that? 22. Wow. And I remember coming to what was a huge church for me and just wondering, how could I engage this church and this community? I mean, I was 22, scared to death, had no idea what I was doing. And I remember early on I made a lot of excuses on why this person wasn't going to ever come to church. And the thing is, I knew these people. You understand? I was from here. So I really had, that's good and bad, you know? Sometimes it's good to know your mission field, and other times it's bad to know your mission field. You understand? It's a double-edged sword. But I made a lot of excuses. I remember I made a lot of excuses internally. Well, I was going to have a hard time doing this and a hard time doing this, and I didn't see how I was going to do this. And I remember early on in being here that part of the objectives given to me as the youth minister in that time was I needed to take a mission trip. I'd never taken a mission trip, sad to say. Never taken a mission trip with a bunch of people. So the only contact I knew of was Robert Wilson's son, Jonathan. He was actually the youth pastor at the church where he had previously been the youth pastor at the church where I had left in Concord, Virginia. And so I called Jonathan up. Now, remember how old am I? Well, now I'm 23, okay? So I called Jonathan up. I said, Jonathan, I have no idea. I'm new to Southern Baptist. I'm new to everything here. You're going to have to help me. I know the North American Mission Board does these mission trips. Tell me where I should go. What's the best mission trip you think is happening this year for youth? You know what his response was? Wait for it. New York City. I said, are you sure, Jonathan? He says, it's a great one. So at 23, I informed all the parents that I'd be taking their youth to New York City. And then they were nutty enough to let me do it. They said, great. Sign us up. Our ministry area was from Central Park to the Empire State Building. And in between there was a little church plant. So I remember we were on Long Island University's campus. We catch the subway into the city. And why did God do that? Why did He put me there? Well, we're looking at churches, right? We'll look at the ancient church of Philadelphia. But I remember I walked into New York City. I'm literally standing in the middle of Times Square, and right in the middle of Times Square, there's a little teeny little church. And what did I see? A church grinding it out in a hard place, grinding it out. I mean, throngs of people would come rushing off the subway, and there would be little volunteers from the church giving out coffee to morning commuters with stickers on it about the church. There would be people rushing up to their place and little volunteers from the church giving out breakfast bars for people who hadn't gotten them with little stickers on about the church. They put on shirts in kind of grimy places and start picking up trash, and people would walk by and see a little bit of information about the church. And I remember standing in the middle of Times Square and says, my excuses are over. If this little church in this little place can grind it out enough to get an audience before people in this place with all this busyness, I now have no excuse. I said, I would much rather be talking to somebody coming out of Granny B's
who actually I might know, you know, and who actually might want to talk to me than somebody hard charging up the sidewalk in a business suit who could care less about me being there. And I thought, shame on me. There must have been this whole time doors of opportunity for ministry that I had rationalized away, I had pushed away, and I remember that that began building in me. Now it's 2004, and you know what the sad thing is about it? I did almost nothing with it. 2005, 2006, 2007, guess what? I'm not doing anything with it. I know I need to be doing, I'm not doing anything. Finally, about 2008, I couldn't handle it anymore. I said, I can't be here at Liberty. I'll leave or I'll stay, but if I stay, I have to start doing something to engage these folks. I can't do this. It's just not part of my DNA to do this. And now look at it. We do things now. And it's not now because I just think them up. You think them up now. How can we get in the midst of people? How can we seize every God-given opportunity for God's glory? I do believe at this point in our church's life, more doors of opportunity are open to us than have ever been open to us. And so especially today, as we look at this text, Revelation chapter 3. If you got your Bibles, let's go there. Jesus talks about an open door today. Revelation chapter 3, verses 7 through 13. We will see the need to take God-given opportunities that He has given us. The first point today is that when Jesus shows up to church, He looks for faithful people in His church to bless. God just wants somebody to care. He just wants somebody living the Christian life, caring about His priorities, that He can say, yes, I want to do something much bigger through you. Verse 7 says, to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, the Holy One, the true One, the One who has the key of David, who opens and no one will close, and closes and no one opens, says, I know your works, because you have limited strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. Let's go to the church at Philadelphia. Philadelphia, not Pittsburgh, or what is it? Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, not Pennsylvania, another Philadelphia, an equally important Philadelphia, a very good church in a prosperous place. A church located on the major trade routes. The seven churches of the book of Revelation are kind of the big cities off the big roads. You understand? That's just the way they go. So here's another one. One of the big claims to fame for Philadelphia was it had very fertile soil. It grew primarily grapes and corn in that particular region due to this very fertile soil. The fertile soil had a positive and a negative. The soil was fertile because of volcanic ash. The negative, the soil was fertile because of volcanic ash, which means, boom, the thing could blow. And it did blow one time, and the whole place went down. They had to rebuild it back up again. But Jesus shows up to this church, and He comes with three terms. Remember, every time the same Jesus shows up, but He shows up with a different presentation. He shows up in a different way, just... Sometimes God shows up to us, same person, but in different ways. He sometimes comes in hard charging. He sometimes comes in very lowly and humble and compassionate and soft, right? Same Jesus, different ways. And so He shows up to the church of Philadelphia with three particular names. First of all, the Holy One. Actually, the most famous term for God, or the most favorite term for God by Isaiah the prophet, was the Holy One of Israel. Notice what's left off. The Holy One of Israel. He's just the Holy One. He's the unique one above everybody, and He's not just for one group. He's now for every group. So he's the Holy One. He's the true one, which means there are other people competing for who is God and what is he like. Jesus says, I'm him. You've seen me, you've seen God. I'm him. And then this final phrase, the one who has the key of David. David, the greatest king of Israel. David, the one in which Israel reached its zenith. And evidently, we will see here in a moment that this little church at Philadelphia is being hammered by the religious community. See, most early Christians were Jewish, or at least a lot of them were. And Jesus was the Messiah who now fulfilled the promises given to David. God made a covenant with David that his kingdom would never end, that he would reign on David's throne forever and ever, you see. And Jesus says, all those promises made to him are fulfilled in me, and I'm the one who unlocks now all of those promises, and I don't care what the other communities say around you, church. And Jesus comes to Philadelphia, and he says, I know your works. Last week, Sardis, they didn't have any works. They're just dead. So it's actually nice for works to be evaluated. Actually, Sardis, there's really nothing positive said about them. That was last week. Philadelphia, in some ways, there's nothing negative said about them. There's really kind of two churches that get a very positive report card, Smyrna and Philadelphia. Out of seven, there are two that get a positive report card. And today, Philadelphia gets a positive report card. But notice the Church of Philadelphia. The Church of Philadelphia gets an A+, at least an A-, A+, A- in that area, a very positive report card. But the Church of Philadelphia is, in some ways, a small church, a pressed church, a church that has only a little strength. They're a church that's been under pressure for a while. They're a faithful band of people, but they have kept the name of Jesus strong, and they've not denied his name nor his word. And notice what's going to happen. Jesus wants to take a faithful band of Christians and now turn them into a, not just a faithful church, but he wants to turn them into a faithful church movement. We'll see that in a moment. You know, I think the first application point here is God is looking for faithful people. God's looking for a faithful band of churches. Churches should never aspire to do any more than God wants them to do. Sometimes the best thing a church can do is focus on rooting out all the problems it has before it tries to reach anybody else. I really believe that. Sometimes a church needs to stare its own self in the mirror and work out some problems, and that needs to be what it focuses on. But notice the Church of Philadelphia is this little band of people, and they're just faithful. You know, sometimes we become Christians, we become part of a church, and a lot of my Christian life has just been living in some ways the normal Christian life, participating in the ebb and flow of Christian life and church life, organizing many of the same programs, you know, just hanging out with you, right? Just living the normal Christian life. By the way, there's nothing wrong with that. Actually, everything's right with that. You understand? Just, it doesn't have to be spectacular every moment, you understand? You can. My theory is God will never do more with you until you are content with just Him, His Word, prayer, just living the Christian life. I mean, that's what our first objective is. The Christian never shoots for success. He shoots for faithfulness to what God calls him to do. Not success in the way men see it, but faithfulness in the way God sees it, which can be very different. And the Church of Philadelphia, from the outside looking in, we might not have given them as great of a report card as Jesus did. Because he looks at them, he says, well, you don't have a lot of strength, but you're a faithful group of people. And you've been tested, and you've been kicked around, and you've been challenged, and there you are. But you know what's interesting is that the Bible says that man looks out on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. God knows the heart of churches. God knows the heart of people. And God knows deep down inside if you really want it, if you really want to be for His kingdom or you don't. And I will just say something. The moment where we're just comfortable to just be faithful to God, I do believe at that moment, and be comfortable to say, here I am, God, do whatever you want me to do. If you want me to go into total obscurity and minister for your name, or if you want me to talk to thousands for your name, whatever it is, I'm up for it. I think at that moment, God will say, now I really want to do something with you. It's almost as if God waits for the church at Philadelphia to just bump along year after year, struggling and having a little strength. And God says, now, I've seen your faithfulness. I've seen how you've managed smaller things in men's eyes. But I see something in you that's great. And now I want to do something with it. Notice the church that Jesus says, I am going to give you an opportunity now that nobody but your disobedience can stop. Wouldn't you like an opportunity that nobody could stop except you? By the way, plenty of people are going to try to stop the Church of Philadelphia. Jesus actually says, and this group's going to try to stop you, and this group's going to stop you, but remember, I'm the one who opens the door that no one can close, and I'm the one who closes the door that no one can open. And the only person that's going to stop this is you. So the second point, notice what Jesus does. When Jesus shows up to church, he places before us opportunities so that his church can flourish. The latter part of verse 8, Jesus says, look, which is oftentimes our problem. We don't see them. Look, evidently they didn't see it. Look, I have placed before you an open door that no one is able to close. Now he watches this. Take note. There's people going to try to shut it. Take note. I will make those the religious community that's going to attack the church. And by the way, Jesus says the ones who are attacking the church is not the religious community, but Satan motivating a religious community, by the way. He says, I will make those from the synagogue of Satan who claim to be Jews and are not, but are lying. Note this, I will make them come and bow down at your feet, and they will know that I have loved you, because I have kept my command to endure. That's one front that's going to try to stop them. Notice this, and I will also keep you from the hour of testing that is going to come over the whole world to test those who live on the earth. That's a political oppression that's going to come and primarily focus on Christians. And Jesus says, I'm going to keep you from that one too. So here it is, the open door. You see this? Two places. It's not as though Jesus is going to open an open door apart from conflict. He's going to open a door in the midst of conflict and keep his church from it. And basically, why does God not just delete, by the way, these forms of opposition? Because in the midst of that, they're going to have to trust God to walk through the open door, that he actually has opened it and he'll actually sustain his church. You understand? You say this open door language, where is it at? Well, Paul uses this idea of an open door multiple times. 1 Corinthians 16, don't turn there, just listen. Paul says, but I will stay in Ephesus until Pentecost because a wide door for effective ministry has opened for me, yet many oppose me. Same context. You see this? There it is, an opportunity. Or in 2 Corinthians 2:12, Paul says, when I come to Troas for the gospel of Christ, a door was opened to me by the Lord. You see? Or in Colossians 4:3, at the same time, pray also for us that God may open a door for us for the message to speak the mystery of the Messiah for which I am in prison. What is an open door? An open door is a divinely given opportunity for God's ministry to move forward. That's what an open door is. And most interestingly about the church at Philadelphia, Jesus has to say
look. There it is.
You know, I think we have to be awake to God-given opportunities. You know, I think this is why we need to be in communion with God, because oftentimes we'll be in a situation, and you know what Jesus will say? Look. You know, interestingly, at 22 years of age, or 23 years of age, God had to take me all the way to the streets of New York City, a very unlikely place, to go look. I'm tired of your excuses, Rusty. Look, sometimes God has to put you around a certain type of Christian person. You know, some people say there's nobody in the world to reach. Go hang around some people who are Christians. Every conversation that they have. I go out, and I'll be honest, I'm convicted by them. I go out to dinner with some people who are not obnoxious. Who are not obnoxious. But before they finish their meal, the waiter's down crying, giving them all their prayer requests. And God's like, look, did you not see that? I mean, how many other people do I have to put around you to just see the doors of opportunity that are all around you? Just look. Be awake. I mean, it doesn't take a lot of looking right now, does it, to see that God is giving Liberty Baptist a great time of opportunity for ministry. Does it take a lot of perception to see that? I don't think it takes a lot. I mean, we're finishing up a building. The community is everything we seem to do. The community will show up to it. Our services are well attended. Our Sunday school and small group classes are helping a lot of people. Does it take a lot to see? Look. And yet I think every time we look, we can see more opportunity. You know, sometimes it's if you do one thing, then three more opportunities come out of it. Have you noticed this? And if you do the wrong thing, three more disadvantages come out of it. It's the way, kind of the way life particularly works. But I want to spend the last few moments talking about the last point. It doesn't take a lot for us to see it. The third and final point, Jesus has to not just say, look, see it. That is not oftentimes the hardest problem. That is a hard problem to see it. But remember what happened in my story? I saw it, and then what did I do about it? Nothing. What happens to us? You know what I'm saying? We just can't seem to get up enough mojo to make something happen sometimes. The third and final point, when Jesus shows up to church, he calls us to grab hold of the opportunities, to grab hold of the rewards he offers to us. The one thing about an open door that God opens, at some point in time, it does what? Closes. The door of opportunity ends. The conversation that he gave the opportunity for ends. The group of people that you could have reached, no longer, they just fall all to pieces and they're not there anymore. I mean, some of you could think back over your life and quite frankly, you could see a lot of missed opportunities and some taken opportunities, couldn't you? But look what Jesus says, I am coming quickly. Don't you hear urgency in that? Church, you got a little strength, you got a door, but I'm coming. And he says, hold on to what you have so that no one takes your crown. The victor, I will make him a pillar in the sanctuary of my God, and I will never go out, and he will never go out again. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and my new name. Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. The last thing Jesus says is, now take it. Take the open door. Lay hold of the God-given opportunities. You know, I hear this all the time. I've heard multiple stories of people in this church who come, they attend, they even almost get involved in something, they almost do something, they kind of get convicted, but guess what they don't do? Do it. just don't do it. And sometimes it's the same process. It just takes time for them to kind of get into it, to grow into it, to move into it. And so I'm going to, you know, there's a thin line between seeing and doing. There's a thin line between knowing and acting. There's a thin line between shallow commitment and all in. So guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to push a little bit. October the 4th is going to be Harvest Day. Harvest Day, our 181-year anniversary. And I'm not going to let you off the hook of this series without some type of response. I mean, we should respond, shouldn't we? Haven't we heard a lot? Last week, churches are dying, churches are compromising, you know, churches are missing open doors. Next week, churches are lukewarm, and Jesus is so tired of them, he doesn't know what to do with them. You know, he's ready to throw them out, and they're ready to throw him out too. You know what I'm saying? And we're hearing a lot of information, and this is what I want you to do. I want you to envision with me a large wall. You ready? You're visioning it? I'm going to finish right on time here. Envision with me a large wall. And envision on that wall, well, at least 450 ideas. Because there's how many of you? About 450. This is what I want you to do. You say, who's going to write all these ideas? Huh? You. In the back, in that vestibule, in this vestibule right over here, point over there. Just make sure you're awake. Oh, yeah, come on, point. Because let me tell you, I don't know how some of you listen. But somebody's going to be over in this vestibule looking for the card. I'm just going to tell you. I mean, you think, I've just been a minister long enough to know how this goes. Somebody be over here, I don't see them. They're right over here, and they're different colors, by the way. They're bright colors. You can pick your color. There are four colors. Okay? All right, now pay attention, please. Before October 4th, which gives you this Sunday and next Sunday, I want you to take a card, and it's the information is back there. The phrase, I will build God's church by, B-Y, dot, dot, dot. And then I want you to write on this particular card, the particular thing God is calling you to do to build his church. And when we walk in somewhere in this building, I haven't decided, when we walk in on October 4th for our 181-year anniversary, you know what we should see? A wall full of ideas. Not about buildings, but about people who are committed to do specific things that the Lord of the church has asked them to do. And by the way, if I get 15 cards back, guess how many I'm going to put up? 15. If I get 100 cards back, I'm going to put up 100. Don't let me down. Don't let God, you let me down. That doesn't mean anything, does it? Every person has a role to play. Every person has a task to achieve. I will build God's church by. Write it down. And then on the wall it will go. And Harvest Day, October the 4th, guess what you get to do? You get to be encouraged. Because you walk around, and you know what I'm going to do, and the elders are going to do, and the staff is going to do? We're going to read these. You don't have to put your name on it. If you want to, I don't care. You don't have to, but if you want to, I'm not going to stop. You can put whatever you want on the card, to be honest. Because I'd like to see what God is laying on your heart to do. Because I'm going to read all of those. The leaders of the church are going to read all of those. And then we'll actually get to see, not what we want to do, but what God is telling you to do. And then it's going to be our responsibility to try to organize this group for that purpose. I will build God's church by. And if you know what? This is a little card. It seems so not intimidating, doesn't it? You know what some of you are going to do? You're going to sit at home and you're going to go, I already know it's going to happen. And then some of you are going to cop out and not put something on it. And if even that's the case, you know what? If you can't write something on this card, you know what I want you to do? I just want you to lay it on your nightstand. And I want you to look at that blank card and just say, why can't I do something? It's a little bigger than a 3x5 card. It's just a card. It's just a statement. Can I not come up with one thing that I'm doing that God is laying on my heart to build his church? Can I not do that? Can I not? One thing. And so if you don't fill it out, just take it home, just tape it right up on your mirror. Just look at it. And just say, or actually, better thing, I am doing nothing. Write it on there and stick it on the. Well, okay, we laugh. Only 2 out of 7, remember? 2 out of 7 got a positive report card. So if these other churches would have done that thousands of years ago, a lot of them would be doing nothing, right? They'd just say, I'm doing nothing. Just put it on the board. So there it is. My final, I lied to you, didn't mean to. I'm 5 minutes over. Will you seize, here it is, will you seize your God-given opportunities to build his church? By the way, that's for the Christians. Some of you today, by the way, are seated in this audience. You're not a Christian. There's never been a time nor a place where you've trusted in Jesus as your Savior. Quite frankly, I'm not asking you, if you're not a Christian, if there's never been a time or a place where you've said, God, I admit I'm a sinner. God, I trust in you. I'm not asking you to build God's church. I'm actually asking you to be a part of it. You say, how do I become a part of God's church? Through faith in Jesus. And if you're here today and you're not a Christian, I'll be right down the front. I can take the Bible and show you how you can be a Christian. But Christians, Jesus is here. And he has shown up to this church through his word. May we respond to him as appropriate. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you that the many open doors that are now available to us, available to individual Christians, available to us as a church, may we seize upon them. May we not make excuses. But God, may we not just be hearers of the word, but may we now be doers of it. God, even during this time of invitation, Holy Spirit, may you communicate to each person their role to play in your greater church building, kingdom advancing plan. In Jesus' name, amen.
Stand together. Stand together.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from love to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name.
Just the illumination of your word into our life. God, may we not just see words on a page. God, may we see God-given, God-ordained opportunities that now set before us. God, may we believe that you open doors that no one can close. And indeed, you close doors that no one can open. God, may we trust you. God, may you instruct us on how it is that we are to now participate in your church. May we be faithful. And God, may you use us to be a blessing to others. God, would you help us? In Jesus' name, amen.
Put your name.